going to invoke some privilege, I think I still have to have him under oath.
He's not invoking any privilege, he's not testifying.
He's just going to decline to comply with the subpoena.
He's here, but he's not going to testify.
Mr. Ruder?
Yes.
As part of your case, did you intend to call Officer Groner?
We listed Officer Groner as a witness in our report. However, in light of the witnesses we have available, we don't have so many necessary calling. But I still have reserved opportunity to do so if I can see that.
He's still under subpoena. So, he's going to swear this witness, and then we'll cross that bridge when we get there.
Do you swear by Almighty God, the searcher of all hearts, that the evidence you should give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and that as you shall answer to God at the last great day?
As the first witness we call Dennis Anderson. Direct your attention to an incident to the other date this year, June 25th of this year. Do you recall that date?
Yes, sir.
Why is that date significant to you?
That is the date in which I was arrested in the Denali County.
At what time, or where were you when that happened?
I was leaving from a meeting at the Community Empowerment Association in Oklahoma.
Mr. Anderson, I'm going to direct your attention to a photograph that is that of the officer here, and that of this listener. Would you describe the location identified in that photograph?
That is Kelly Avenue, Kelly Street. Looks like the back of the YMCA over there to my left, and look to the right is the CEAD, Community Empowerment Association.
Just for clarity in the record, what is the Community Empowerment Association?
Pardon?
For the record, what is the Community Empowerment Association?
It's pretty much an organization that deals with to the Humboldt community. And I was there to the meeting that was going on, there's some issues that was going on. Our plan was put together for an urban agenda to help with some of the issues within the city.
Okay. And are you a regular participant in those meetings at the community in Maryland Association?
This particular meeting that we had in the time, I had been working with that committee for probably a course of 3 to 4 months prior.
Okay. And on the night in question, you had been attending a meeting at CEA?
Correct.
And following the meeting, what happened?
As I was exiting the meeting, an individual came to me asking me if you had a business card. Oh, yeah, that's for some names. To picture of any business that we get. I told him that I didn't have any press information on me right now. He didn't even want to share a picture with me. I said, if you want to call me, the business card is just going to be called and give me my name. As he went to the car, I retrieved the business card, gave him the business card, shut the door, and I'm pretty much ready to go and leave in front of him. And as I gave business card from Sylvia, he wanted to give me his contact information, so he sends information. That's when we see police car coming across the intersection.
I want to be very clear about what happened before we get the police car coming. Who is the other individual?
His name is Rosano Stewart. He's a reporter from the court, the fifth report.
Okay, and just to be very clear, because you're speaking quickly, I want to make sure I understand. He was inquiring about...
It was the event that had took place probably about 2 or 3 weeks prior, in which I asked the shooter that had received an award and he had covered that event. He wanted the name before the court and had published the story.
Okay. So he wanted to discuss some photographs you had in your possession, sir?
He had them in his possession.
He had them in his possession.
He wanted the names for attachment.
Okay. So you exited the building, and if we're looking at the photograph that is a representation of the community, the back of the community, or is that the front of the back, sir?
This would be the front, third street, is the front of the community.
Okay. On the, there is a car parked against the curb, which is next to a tree. Can you see that, sir?
Yes, I can.
Is that close to where you were? Or in relationship to that automobile, could you explain where you were when you were having a conversation with Mr. Stewart?
Approximately right behind that car is where I was parked at.
Okay. And you were having a brief conversation, and were you on the sidewalk side or were you on the street side?
We were on the street side, on the driver's side door.
Okay. Because you had to retrieve something from the driver's side?
Yes. And I was planning on entering into the car once I got into that condition.
How far from the car was it?
We were right next to the car. We were standing at the door.
And how long were you speaking before the police car drove by?
Maybe about 30 seconds, 45 seconds, whatever it takes to pretty much extend your business card and contact information.
Okay, what was the level of conversation you had? Was it a loud tone, a quiet tone, did you explain?
No, it was just casual, just conversation about exchanging information. And then I inquired briefly about the contact at the court for another project that was going to do with the student. And I was just asking him, if he had contact and the tour didn't get them, so I contacted him. And that was just a simple conversation.
Okay. After about 30 seconds, you stated, you testified earlier that there was a police car came by?
Yeah, we were wrapping up. Mr. Rosado, we were done with the conversation when we seen the car. So we just kind of stopped and we've seen a car coming across the street. Where we cut some car across the intersection and we've seen him picking up speed. And so we just stayed there in the car, which we've seen the police car driving. And we figured we'd be pursued because we started picking up more and more speed. Then it got weird with the fact that while we were standing by the car, the police car continued to veer closer to right where we were standing. And that's where just a little thrown off by the school to the right, but we continue to maintain speed and continue to come closer. Just what was going on, we were all standing there next to the car. We did not know we were waiting for a police car to go past before we were leaving out the back of the car. However, if the car continued to move toward us, that's when we had to press up against the car to avoid having any of the car hit us in any way. Mr. Anderson, I'm going to slow down. Mr. Anderson, when you're talking about the car, the police car was coming down the road. On this photograph, there's two lanes. There's a left lane and a right lane. The left lane is the lane that's closest to the car as you testified earlier as you were standing next to it, correct?
The left lane,
in the photograph. Okay. Was the police car coming through that lane, which would be the left lane in the photograph?
Police car was coming down the left lane. It would be right side of the street where we were sitting. It was coming down the left lane.
Okay, was there traffic on the other side of the street? There's
no opposing traffic.
And the car was driving, the police car was driving in the middle of the lane initially, sir?
The police car started off just driving in the lane, but it continued to veer to the right. But yes, it started off, it wasn't as close to us. It wasn't as far to the right as it was until he got closer to us.
So as it approached you, it became closer to you?
Correct.
When it passed you, was it going at a higher rate of speed or a slower rate?
So it went at a higher rate of speed.
And how close did it pass to me?
I want to say approximately about a foot. You see the flesh or anything, it was a chance of being clipped by a car. And it was at a higher rate of speed.
If you had not moved closer to the car, to your officer, were you worried about getting hit? You testified earlier that you moved closer to the car, correct?
Correct.
Why did you move closer to the car?
Well, my own safety. It wasn't just my feeling this way. There was both of us. I mean, this is all within a matter of seconds where we both had to move up against this car for our own personal safety. So we don't get clipped or hit by this car.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. After the car passed you, did it continue to veer towards the side of the street you were on, or did it recenter itself?
Once the car passed me, it did go back into the middle of the lane again, and it actually de-escalated as well.
Okay. And what happened after the car passed you? What did you do?
Once the car passed, I seen the brake lights hit and seen the car de-escalate, and I seen it veer back out to the middle. And there's also part of us that we need to come and fall car feeling like this endangered and said, well, this was just what happened. I made an explanation of why, so as I stepped back away from the car and just released myself from what I just had.
Okay, and how loudly did you say the word loud?
I said it loud.
Okay, and why did you say it?
More so, I was just shocked. It was just a response of what I just encountered.
And after you made that explanation, what happened?
As soon as I made the explanation, the patrol car did immediately turn and pulled right back up to where we were standing in my car.
So as you made your explanation, the car immediately turned around?
Correct.
Were there other cars near
the police car when it turned around?
No other cars in the street. Okay. When it turns around, what speed did it maintain as it approached you again?
It was probably, now it was a little bit slower. The quick turn when it came back, probably normal speed that should be driving the residential lane, and then it stopped in front of us.
What happened after the car stopped, the police car stopped?
Once the police car stopped, Officer Gordon Dennison, I had a problem. And I did explain to him, yes, I did have a problem, but he did, it was inappropriate, and I would have been in management.
I'd like to stop you right there. You said Officer Gromit did this thing. Did you know Officer Gromit before him?
No.
Okay. And how did you come to know Officer Gromit?
He tried to put me with his car.
Okay. I'm going to direct your attention to the gentleman in the uniform, seated in the front row of the gallery. Is that Officer Gromit?
That's Officer Gromit.
So Officer Gromit exited the car, and he said something first, was it he or
he said when he pulled up, he asked, is there a problem?
And what did you say when he asked if you had a problem?
When he asked if I had a problem, so yes I did, I probably did, because I was inappropriate, and I was like, Dr. Bison and his supervisors. His name is Jackson.
Okay, why did you ask that?
Because I wanted to follow up the complaint on his actions in the streets as far as how he drove the homes.
Why did you want to follow up the complaint?
Because he's dangerous.
Okay. After you stated to me what his dad's number is, what happened next?
At that point, and even when the first came up, you see him, when he took any witness, just from the look on his face, he kind of had like a smirk on his face when he asked me had a problem. Once I asked for his dad's number, that's when he stepped out of his car. His car stayed there in the middle of the street. He stepped out of the car. And he said, "Man, you want to file a complaint on me? I need your name and your, I'm sorry, I need your driver's license." At that point, I went to my wallet and I gave him my pocket, I gave him my driver's license. And then I did say to him, "I don't know why you need my driver's license, but we'll file a complaint on you." However, here it is, I had to give him my license. From there, he asked for the other individual, Mr. Rosano, about his license as well. And Mr. Rosano asked the same thing, "Why do you need a license? We didn't do anything." There was never anything said about why he wanted a license. From there, he stepped up to give him a license, so now he's on the street because he was parked there on the right-hand side of here. But he was parked on the lane, so we had to step out and give him a license as he was stepping out of this car, so we met him halfway in the middle of intersection, you know, that's when another individual was walking past and was asking why was the officer asking for a license and being so forceful with us and so demanding. At that point, the officer told the individual to just mind his business, keep on walking. And because of the officer's actions, from the time that he pulled up on us to when he did the U-turn, come back and, step out the car, ask for it. I just felt uncomfortable, so I asked other individual if he could stay there because I heard somebody was watching this going on.
Who was the second individual who was there joining you and Mr. Stewart?
That would be Mr. Philip Brown.
Mr. Philip Brown.
Philip Brown, thank you. I'm sorry, Brandon Phillips, I'm sorry. Brandon Phillips. Thank you. Please continue. At that point, Officer Romek seemed to be even more agitated than I asked Mr. Phillips to stay there. And that's when he then told us to walk over to the sidewalk. At this point, I had no idea where he was coming from. But when he was walking to the sidewalk, he was radio and he was ready for backup because that's what happened. I had no idea what that was about. So then I did tell him I have a phone in my hand already for insurance contact information. I told him at that time, I don't know where this is going, so from here on out, I'm looking forward to the start of the conversation. And at that point, that's when he said, "You can't do that." And I said, "If I can," he said, "Give me your phone." And I told him, "I can record it." And he's like, "Well, you can't. I'm going to have every right to do it." And that's where, that's when he pretty much said, "If you don't turn off your phone," he said, "Put your hands behind your back." And that's where I was just like, "For what?" And then he was just like, "If you don't put your hands behind your back, you just sit arrest." At that point, I passed my phone over to Mr. Uzama. And I just asked him, "Could you please keep this recording?" I put my hands behind my back. So Roman didn't walk right past me. He never put cuffs on me. He walked past me, grabbed Officer Uzama, and put the handcuffs on Uzama. So he grabbed Uzama, put the handcuffs on Uzama. I apologized to Mr. Uzama because, I felt he was going to be handcuffed because I had been giving him my phone. And I was still standing there waiting for him to finish up with Mr. Rosano. Mr. Rosano still questioning why are we handcuffing us, why are we under arrest. It was never a response at all as to why he was handcuffing us. He came back to me, I stayed there waiting for him with my hands behind my back. He twisted my arm up and just shoved my left arm up my back even further. He cuffed me.
This is why you're standing. You were standing with your hand behind your back. Is that correct? Were you moving at all?
No.
Okay. And were your wrists far apart or close to that?
No. I'm not the most flexible guy in the world. It's as close as I can put on behind my back as I could be able to.
Okay. And after your hands were back
twisted it up further off of my back. Like it was a twist and cut was just my left arm was cranked up pretty nice on that.
Okay.
And after this was happening for the Rosado, during this time when Mr. Rosado was being handcuffed, you weren't moving around or anywhere moving around?
Did I go anywhere?
Okay.
So were you speaking? Were you still speaking to the officer at that time?
Both Mr. Rosado and I were both speaking to the officer asking why we were in the arrest, what did we do by putting handcuffing us? But we didn't go anywhere, we didn't resist anything, we stood there, as I didn't do what we were doing. But we did question why, because we didn't know why we were being arrested.
Okay.
After you were handcuffed, sir, what occurred?
After I was handcuffed, he then told me to sit on the ground. And the way my arm was raised, I just couldn't move, and I was just trying to, mentally, I was just trying to move my arm. And he gave me an order again, sit down on the ground. Like I said, my hands are cuffed behind my back, a little awkward, and he just expected me to sit down on the ground, and I couldn't position myself where I could really sit. And then he said, if I tell you to sit down on the ground again, I'll take you down. No sooner than he said that, it was a slam, it was a media slam. I never responded to him the first couple of times he told me to sit on the ground, primarily because my mind was just trying to push my arm back to a position where that's all I was focused on, was untwisting my arm. But he said it once, maybe twice, but definitely by the time he said, you don't sit down and put you down, as soon as he said, I'm going to put you down, he swept my legs from under me and slammed me from my back. Would you explain more specifically, sir, what you mean by swept your legs? How did you sweep your legs?
It was pretty much just like a put his leg behind my legs and took his arms and just flipped me over his legs and onto my back and my shoulder.
Okay, how do you land, sir?
I landed on my right shoulder, I'm sorry, my left shoulder, back on my neck. I landed shoulder, back shoulder first.
Can you explain how that felt? Landed to?
Felt like a slam. It was an impact, it was definitely an impact. I mean, I know a guy, especially when your hand up behind you, you can't really brace yourself. I did try to use my shoulder as I was falling back. I tried to brace myself on my shoulder versus flat on my back and back in my head. I did end up with a pretty nice size bruise and scar on my shoulder after the slamming. It was a pretty nice impact.
After you landed on your shoulder, what happened?
Once I was down on the ground, I then looked up and I seen a couple of kids or young men up in the parking lot at the YMCA that was recording the whole thing. And I'm still in shock. I'm not understanding why I'm not arrested. I'm not understanding why I'm still on the ground. And I seen the kids in the parking lot recording, and I had asked them, as soon as I seen that, you know, I just asked them, I said, did y'all record it? And they said, yes, we did. And then I just lay there, and that's when Officer Gomez noticed it as well. He told them to get out, and they replied back that we don't have to go anywhere. We can stand over here with the videotape. And then I asked Officer Gomez again while I was laying there, why am I under arrest? But I was on the ground, I was handcuffed, there's nothing I could do. And the only thing I wanted to know at that time was why this situation is going on.
So you continued to talk to the Officer Gomez while you were on the ground?
While I'm under arrest. And then there was still no response, and he went back to attending to Wodong, and I think at that time the crowd started gathering around what's going on, and it was pretty much an important conversation with Roman. Until he came back at a later point to ask me if I wanted to help out. And I had told him at the time, I mean, I didn't want him to touch me again, and I told him I'm fine, I just wanted to pull him right here. And then I said,
did he offer any further explanation?
No.
Okay, did you continue speaking with Officer Gomez after he made that explanation?
No.
Okay. And was there a crowd of people gathering around?
Yeah, I really couldn't see. I did see some people that gathered in the parking lot. They were pretty much, on the picture there, they were like beyond that grass point. Nobody had ever seen beyond the grass. So they were up there in the parking lot where the cars were pretty much just videotaping.
So
So they did go on the grass, or they did not go on the grass. They stayed in the parking lot and did this. And you were on, I want to be really clear about this, because in this get reviewed in the transcript that looked at, sometimes it might not be as clear to the people who understand it right now. There's the road, and then there's a strip of grass, and then there's a strip of sidewalk, and then there's another strip of grass, and then there's a parking lot. The onlookers were residing where?
Second strip of grass right before the parking lot, right here before the parking lot.
The second strip of grass in between the sidewalk and the parking lot, sir?
Correct. It was in the parking lot, not the grass, it was in the parking lot.
Okay, I'm sorry.
It was in the parking lot. We never stepped on that grass.
Thank you. So the only people who were close to you while this was occurring were Mr. Groman, Officer Groman, and Mr. Were you lying on your shoulder this whole time after you were slamming your shoulder? I know the officer offered to help you get up. Did you bring yourself up to a sitting position, or were you still lying down?
I couldn't bring myself up to a sitting position because my arm was still contorted a little bit, so I just lay there, like just subside, and I landed on my arm that I could stay on my back.
Approximately how long were you there lying on the ground?
Until other officers arrived to the scene, and then they assisted me up. Okay, so it was probably about 2 minutes.
And after the other officers arrived on the scene, just to be clear, how many officers arrived?
I couldn't see. I was able to hear a commotion. I mean, I heard Officer Gorman continue to tell people to stay away. People came out asking what's going on. And this is after the cops on the ground, and I started hearing more people. And as I was on the ground, if you don't mind, if I do want to go back, when I was on the ground, as I was laying there, I heard the dog. I'm sorry, it's still there. There was commotion. I was going back and telling people to get back. And then there were more cars coming on the scene. I couldn't see anything, but then I also heard the dog barking. It kind of felt kind of crazy. But I couldn't see because where I was laying, there were other cars parked.
Sir, after the other officers helped you up, what happened then?
As other officers helped me up, there was another commanding officer that was on the scene. I know that's kind of started to take control of what was going on. And he had asked Officer Gomez, do you know who was on the list? And he was on the list of handcuffs. And Officer Gomez said he did not. And he was on the list. I'm sorry, the lieutenant, I believe he was the lieutenant, that told him that he was the media, getting out of those cuffs. Was on handcuffs. And that's what he wanted to put him in, was on to take him to the station. Officer Gorman said take him to the station. I was then escorted all the way to my feet. And I was escorted to a wagon and taken downtown to the
Okay, what happened after you arrived at Allegheny County Jail?
Once we got to Allegheny County Jail, we was getting out the car. They had gotten out the wagon, and the officers let me out the wagon. The officers that drove me there, they had my cell phone, and they had my keys, and they asked me, are they just possession? I said, yes, and they, like I said, I put all the stuff in the folder or envelope. And then as they were going to Officer Romick's car, he let them down, and Officer Romick had gotten out of his car, and it came around. And I said, can you put me up with also handing him my license as well? And he just looked at me and just said, I lost it. And I just stunned to him. And from there, he took me to the station.
And how long were you in the jail?
I was in jail from approximately, I don't know if that time I got down there, it might have been about 4 o'clock, until about 8:30 in the morning.
And how old were you released?
I had to post a bail of $5,000, and I was released upon my wife put some bail there for one more.
Mr. Henderson, at some point you were charged with some offenses, correct?
Correct.
I
So is there an answer for Bird to give it to Mike?
There's a stump of them. Stump of them and identify which party is advancing the agenda.
Yeah, for Bird. Mr. Henderson, at some point subsequent to your arrest, did you have the opportunity to
fill out a criminal complaint?
A complaint with the Citizens Police Review Board?
I'm sorry.
Can I have a moment?
Would this be consent to be reported and there's one statement that you offered to the review board?
Yes, it is.
Can I approach? It's a good consent.
Okay. attention. I'd like to direct your attention to, these are two documents that are attached to one another. One is a police criminal complaint. The second one is an affidavit of probable cause. I'd like to direct your attention to page 2 of 3 of the affidavit of probable cause. Please let me know when you get there. Did I do this for murder?
Yes, sir.
In this document, Officer Document alleges that he approached the male to remain in the lane and had slowed his vehicle to avoid him. And that's off the first paragraph on the 4 lines down. Do you see that?
Yes, I do.
Is that accurate?
Not at all.
Would you explain what's inaccurate about it?
We've never slowed down, we've never approached it. Just pretty much, we were never in the lane. He does not act as well.
Judge, same. The question I think is now to make sure you just answer the question about who's been acting.
No, it's not acting.
It states in this report that you began shouting. Is that portion of the report accurate?
That is not accurate.
In the next paragraph, 4 lines down, it says Henderson became visibly angry and started to raise his voice.
Do you recall during that initial conversation you had with Officer Garland, either complaining of anger or raising his voice?
That is not accurate. No, I do not.
Do you see anywhere in this report your request for the data number?
No, I don't.
Judge, this is an affidavit of cause. You objected to the admissibility of all documents that you were putting in the affidavit of cause. My understanding is that one of the charges here is that he has made a false statement. I'm assuming that this affidavit is a false statement.
Yes, and that is where it's also inaccurate.
Not in there, can't be false.
I don't know if I asked if it was false. I think I was asking whether it was incomplete. I mean, whatever the hearing officer wishes, I just want to make sure you understand the information I was trying to elicit from the court.
Right. No, I understand.
Okay.
I've sustained the objection.
Thank you. May I have one moment? I'm going to move to admit this additional document that we have marked for a complaint. Believe me, forgive me if I did not.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So admitted. Mr. Henderson, I want to talk to you about the video that you recorded. How did you record this video? Was it on your smartphone?
Correct.
Did you have the chance to review that video after the incident occurred?
Yes, I did.
You eventually had to see possession of your cell phone back?
Yes, I did.
During your course of review of that tape, didn't appear to act or reply to me.
Here, also, I'm going to seek to introduce the videotape one, which is preloaded onto the screen and back as well. Mr.
Chairman?
No.
Submit.
No, this is not it. We're going to need a little bit more. Excuse me.
Stop playing on the floor.
Yes.
That's all. Don't you like to have it all?
It's fine. Adjourn for a moment to see what that does to the issues.
Thank you.
Is this, Mr. Reuter, is this worked perfectly this afternoon? I apologize, folks. Do we have a minute I can fuss with this?
I'm going to try to do a little bit of things.
I Richards, would you like me to fetch Mr. Campbell?
Stop playing on your phone.
Have a seat.
There we go.
Oh, Bobby.
Now,
Mr. Henderson, just a couple more questions. After this incident took place, did this incident affect your perception of your own did this change your how you think about this we're talking about any statement of charges here. So we talked about conduct. You talked about conduct unbecoming to a member. Certainly, I think the perception of the complaints in terms of the conduct of the subject officer is relevant. I do try to conduct myself as a role model. I do stay in my position as an educator. I don't go out looking for problems with the police. I am one of them. I've always been one to resolve issues. And for an issue to be made and brought on by the Pittsburgh police or a Pittsburgh police officer, it kind of brought back in my face that regardless of some of the things that I might tell my students and even how I want to do things the right way, trouble can still come to you regardless
of how you conduct yourself, because if you haven't been in the wrong place at the wrong time, and the police officer just interprets you as someone that you don't have to show any respect to. And, you know, it really makes me upset that I did see myself just looking, this would have happened when I was younger. I couldn't be a teacher right now. I have a criminal record. Fortunately, I do have friends as police officers. I have neighbors as police officers. So, you know, that kind of balances it out for myself right now at my age. But even at night, you know, it's just like, wow, this is how police work. And it kind of brings it all perspective for, you know, my students and just young people out here that don't know how to handle themselves, that don't communicate effectively. I'm like, if I don't do anything wrong and I get handcuffed and charged with criminal record, and I know I didn't do anything except I exercised the right, yes, obviously there are people getting hit with charges and criminal records without doing anything by the Pittsburgh Police Department. So yeah, it did affect my perception of Pittsburgh Police.
Mr. Henderson, has this incident changed your confidence in the Pittsburgh Police?
I'll let this question, total rule for this question, but I think I understand what you're trying to accomplish. Go ahead, you can answer.
I'll say that it affected my trust in the Pittsburgh Police Department. Just the way everything worked out, I mean, you know, I know Pittsburgh has a lot of good police officers, I know they do, but then it no matter what someone does, you find yourself on the defensive, you know, fighting charges off of you. If there's one or two officers that violate, and you know, yes, it impacted my trust with the Pittsburgh Police. Not all, it's not a blanket, because I know there are a lot of hardworking men and women out there, but you know, there are some out there that just don't follow all the policies that they share, and it does impact the trust between the community and the department.
Thank you. May I have a question?
Yes.
Which I
was one of the topics at that meeting, police community.
Yes, it was.
And what was the tenor of the discussion?
As far as the discussion overall, that piece, I was really tired, it was on the agenda. But they were about getting to me, and I pretty much don't think about education. I had a discussion to the council, so I was thinking that was on the agenda, and we were touching upon, we were having a discussion, but they didn't need to meet that. I'm sorry, I didn't stay for me that, I'm pretty prior to the meeting.
So, could you estimate how long you were there, that part of the discussion?
I'd say, I was prior to the discussion, I had made my report on education, and I had to leave prior to the discussion about the.
So, obviously, you didn't intend to stay for that.
Initially, I stated that something came up with my wife, and that's why I was leaving the meeting.
Now, we have the photo over here of the street that's depicted. What's the name of that street?
Kelly Street.
Kelly Street. And there seems to be an intersection. Is that just going on to a private property, or is that street?
I'm not sure from this perspective, I don't think so.
Okay. Now, is there parking on both sides of the street, at that street?
I really can't say for sure. I believe it's on the right side, but I don't think so for sure.
And it's two-way traffic?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So cars are parked on the, as we're looking at, the left-hand side of the street. How much distance is there from that parked car to the center line?
I really can't say. Measurement line, big enough.
Okay. And if there were cars parked on both sides, cars could pass in their own lanes in both directions. But there wouldn't be a lot of room.
No, there is enough time.
In this particular case, when you left the meeting, did you cross the street or did you come out on the side of the car? And the driver's side of your car would have been facing out towards the middle part of the street.
Correct.
And you had intended to get something for Mr. Stewart, who was with you?
Correct.
And what was it you were going to get for him?
Business car.
And where were the business cars?
In my house.
Okay, so you would have had to open the driver's side door and then reach in to get the car.
Correct.
And after you obtained the cards, I think you said there was then a discussion about some photos.
After I obtained the cards, I shut the door because I didn't know the way that's a narrow street. So I shut the door and then in the exchange contact information.
Okay. And I think you said it was about 40 to 45 seconds.
Approximately.
Now, you could have done that on the sidewalk.
Sorry, if I was sticking around or if I was going somewhere bad, my friend was injuring the car and came along with that.
No, I understand, but Mr. Stewart could have been waiting for you on the sidewalk and you obtained the car. He could have gone on the sidewalk, he was in the car, and answered his during the 40 to 45 seconds, the two of you were in the street.
No, we were next to my car. We were not. There were numerous cars that passed by. There was about three cars that passed by. In fact, there were cars that passed in both intersections at some point. And as I said, Mr. Stewart was about to walk across the street. He had waited for the car to actually come past. And then as he was about to go, we seen the police car coming. And that's. It was from the
now, how far away was the police car when you first saw it?
It had just crossed, I want to say it's, I believe that's Homewood Avenue. It had just crossed that intersection, so we were probably around the middle of the block. If we had seen them come to the intersection, picking up students, and then he was from out to the car.
And how far is that?
Couldn't say for sure. We were in the middle of the block. We were in the description.
Did you say it was hundreds of yards?
I would, yeah, I think that.
Now, you had the impression the police vehicle was on its way to a call?
Correct.
Yeah. Is there any reason then why you and Mr. Stewart didn't get out of the street?
We didn't move because we didn't want to interfere with officers if they knew where we were. And we looked ahead to see how we could get to see what was going on. We took something by the way. Didn't see anything, so we looked back and the car coming. We just stayed where we were, so the officer, you know, it's like pulling over, just staying to the side of the emergency vehicles coming through. So we stayed where we were right next to my vehicle.
But you would have had time to actually leave where you were and stand in front of the car or go stand behind it.
So as we were going, I wouldn't even, not moving. I just, pause. I was going to go through the police yard.
And in fact, that's what it did. It drove by.
You weren't striking. You drove past. You didn't drive by. You drove past.
You mean he's driving along. You say it's not on wide street. He's in his lane.
Correct.
Your car's parked there.
Correct.
So there's very little room in that lane with a parked car for an oncoming car. And you're saying that he took his car and steered it towards your car?
Yes, he did. To the right. And we continued to approach it to the point where there was plenty of room. Square in the state lane, bypass us as many cars, about three cars to get by. He made a point to approach us close. I mean, it became obvious. At first, he just figured it's just a fast car. And it might just be the perception because of the speed. However, once he got closer, it was obvious that it would come closer to the right. And we had to lean up against the car. We literally pushed our whole body back against the car, left against the car, to the stop, to not get hit from certain car vehicle.
Mr. Stewart is there with you. Is he here tonight?
No, he's not.
He's the one that can verify you.
Yes, he can.
Now, when you say you went against the car, is the police car went by? Were the windows up on the police car?
I have no idea.
And you said all you said was, wow.
Correct.
Now, how far did the police car go after it passed you?
It didn't even make it to the corner. It stated he started braking after he passed it, so it started slowing down. And as I came off the car, it was immediate thing as soon as I was leaving from being on the car and feeling that danger, my response was, wow. And he turned right after the intersection, so he wasn't passing that intersection.
Okay, when you say the intersection, now I'm looking at this picture, it appears just beyond the parked car, there's like a driveway. Are you saying he went up to the next street intersection? It wouldn't be shown in the photo.
I'm not sure if that's an intersection or not. Like I said, not really. From this distance, I'm not really sure if that's a street intersection or if it's just into the line we were talking about. So I wouldn't think if that's it or not. But he did not go beyond the street. His response was immediate to a wow. With an immediate response.
And can you give us an estimate, though, how far as far as
the street? How far? Sir, he did not go beyond the intersection.
Now, you say he was going at a high rate of speed. He would have had to slam on his brakes then.
It was obviously there he did his brakes after he passes. You see the brake lights come on, and you see him veer back out towards the center of that lane after he passes. So the very opposite, he slowed down and veered back onto the center.
Now, at any time, if you step out into the street from where you had been, you said up against your car, after his car from
this car had gone by, I stepped away from my car for 2 miles, and it was more so a release stepping away from the car. And at that point, I will note, at that point, I did step beyond where we were standing at that point, it was more so just a release from those actions.
Did you raise your hands or your arms or anything like that?
I'm not sure. Possibly, but I'm not really sure.
Now, at this point, you don't know for sure whether the officer heard you or not.
I don't see any other reason he would have turned around.
Well, if you're out in the street and you're raising your hands, he could have interpreted that to be you wanted to stop and come back.
He didn't ask if he could help.
Well, when he came back, he said,
have a problem, and they're not being responsible for the problem.
Well, do you understand, do you have a problem? I mean, when you sell a gesture to the public, you want to end the stuff.
Could have, but the expression on the states in the body language was not in an assistance approach to the game up.
Were you trying to get his attention and have him come back so you could complain to him if you thought he was driving too fast?
No, I was happy to be loud and not stress my vehicle.
Well, when he did come back, the first thing he said to him was, you didn't like his driving.
No, I didn't say anything. He asked, do I have a problem? And then I did tell him what he did was inappropriate. I didn't tell him I didn't like his driving. I told him what he did was inappropriate. And then I asked him to report his driver's license and his, I'm sorry, his name and his accent.
If you're saying the only thing he said to him, what you did was inappropriate, those are the exact words? Now, when he did get out of the car, he asked you and Mr. Stewart to get out of the street and go up on the sidewalk and lay around.
He got out of his car, he asked us for our license.
But you were asked to go up on the sidewalk and the street.
No, I was asked for my license.
But at some point, you were asked to go up on the sidewalk.
He said when he got out of the car, he asked us if he didn't ask us when he got out of the car. He asked us to drive.
After he got the license, did he ask you to go up on the sidewalk?
No, but at that point, we had turned around and told someone else to keep walking in my business.
Okay. And somebody's come close to where this encounter is?
No, this person was across the street, walking into the meeting that was going on.
Did you call out to anybody who was across the street?
No, I didn't ask that individual after the officer told them to keep walking in my business. I did ask the individual if he could stay until the officer arrived at the
door. Okay, so who was that person?
That was Mr. Brandon Phillips.
Did you know this person?
I know of him through a mutual or my brother-in-law. He was my brother-in-law, so I know of him through that way and just seeing him around the community and things like
that. Did you call out to him by name and ask him to say it?
No, I did not.
At any point, did you call out and ask somebody to go inside the meeting and speak to them?
I did call out for someone to come out after I was put into the ground.
Who did you make that request?
I just asked for the people from the meeting to come out with observers, witnesses, for protecting myself.
Was Mr. Phillips still there?
I can't say.
And in fact, did the people come out from the meeting?
People did come out after I was put into the ground.
Found out subsequently who it was and where any of the people were coming out?
I'm really not sure. Like I said, I didn't really inquire.
Did you hear the officer telling people to stay back? Were those the people that had come out and were gathered around?
I was on the ground at the time of the aircraft and I really don't know who was, what was going on. I couldn't see the street.
And now, as I understand it, when you were handcuffed on the ground, you were just on your side. So you weren't facing out.
No, I was on the back.
You were on the back. Was there any reason why you couldn't see what was going on while you were on your back on the sidewalk?
Because there was cars actually parked. By the time I was up on the curb, I was following the truck to go to the curb after he had called for backup because I had Mr. Phillips to say. That's when he then said, walk up to the curb, and then he called for backup. When I was slammed to the ground, I was slammed to the time where the cars were parked and therefore I couldn't see because I couldn't see my car.
Now you say you were slammed to the ground. Did you hear on that video you were being asked numerous times to get down?
Correct.
How many times did you think he asked you to get down?
Yes, okay.
And you didn't get down, did you?
No, I did not.
Now, you seem to be physically fit, very young man. Is there any reason why you could not get down on the ground?
He had twisted my arm up and it was awkward. I didn't have no way to prepare myself to sit. Again, my arm was extremely uncomfortable. If my arm was in a position that where I had the first time, I'm not committed to the way it was twisted up. There was no way I could really move myself.
Did you ask him? Did you help you get down to the front.
I was actually trying to follow the order, but my main thing was first trying to adjust my arm so that I could see. At that moment, I was kind of really just trying to move my arm. It's kind of, it's a weird experience to get it when you're trying to move and you can't move. And so my attention was all on making a subtle movement and twisting your arm. However, I was kind of tight and awkward and I couldn't move. And I didn't really have a chance to say anything to him before he slammed to the ground.
Now, in listening to that tape and your recollection of what took that day, did you hear him actually give you a warning that if you didn't get down on the ground, he was going to take
it? Yeah, he had a warning, but he didn't give no time to respond to his warning. So as he said his warning, he was on the tape, you hear that I hit the ground within a second of him saying.
Now, when you were listening to the tape, could you hear your voice on that tape? And what was it you were saying on that tape? Because there were numerous voices.
Yeah. I was talking to the people that they recorded. I wanted to make sure that everything was clear, what was going on, why it was going on. I never made any remarks against the officer as far as aggressive attitude. I talked directly to the officer, but I never raised my voice in which I was talking derogatory to them. I didn't ask for any derogatory actions of anyone else, but I did want everybody that was there watching to understand what they were watching.
Now, did you notice on that video that there was an officer in a white shirt picking you up off the ground?
It wasn't him. He came with the white shirt. Officer with the white shirt kind of first came through the dirt. It was two other officers came picking him off the ground.
And did you realize the officer who's in the white shirt is a lieutenant?
I didn't at the time. Later on, I found out the officer in the white shirt was a lieutenant.
And when the lieutenant was there, was he in charge of what was taking place at the scene? Was he giving the
order? It was really kind of chaotic. I really couldn't see what's what. I know he did give Officer Gorman the order to release the German.
In this complaint, your attorney says you don't want to do it.
From my understanding, from my attorney, that's the only thing that you can do. She moved court system. Okay, that's probably not this.
Now, in relation to that charge that was filed by the OMI, that letter you saw that said it was sustained, are you aware that in connection with that, that there was to be a mediation or consideration of that charge? Did anybody contact you and told you
that? I haven't contacted anyone about the mediation.
So nobody contacted you from the Office of Public Safety Director?
Not me directly. I'm not sure if anyone contacted my attorney, but not myself.
Okay. And you're aware in federal court that they mandate that there be a vehicle evaluation, is your attorney just part of that too?
That's something that I really can't answer.
It's remediation. Are you opposed to remediation?
Am I opposed to remediation? Right now, yes, I am.
Thank you. I apologize. I forgot it. The next one, somebody called me chicken wrong. Yeah, so I'm just going to start the next one. Okay, yeah. Jackson, did you have the opportunity to be outside the community of Howard, the Government Association, on the issue?
Yes.
You've been present in the room to hear the testimony of Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Would you explain, did you know Mr. Anderson before that period?
Yes, I do know him.
How did you know him?
My team's still in.
When you
what happened after you called Mr. Henderson and Mr. Stewart. So, based on what I have done by saying about somebody being stopped with drugs, and I saw Mr. Henderson and Mr. Stewart standing there, I thought that maybe, and I saw a police officer sort of standing in between where the car was, out from the street a little, not to the street, but in front of the car. I thought they were having a conversation with him about inquiring about this drug stop, basically. And so when I saw them, I was walking towards that way to see, what was going on. And as I approached and got closer, I noticed that Mr. Henderson and Mr. Stewart were handcuffed. And so I immediately thought, how did that happen? And so as I started to approach, I asked the officer what was going on, and he told me to go come any closer to, get away and not come any closer. So I walked across the street, and I asked the question again. I said, what's going on? Thank you.
Mr.